to the society. So, coming to our topic, there are many recent times we have been observing climate change, that is frequent tropical cyclone, frequent flood, heat waves, drought, wildfire, and cold events. So in recent time also we have been observing in Kerala, in the last month in China, heavy flood, all things. These are all due to the climate change. So what is the reason for this climate change? Because there is a gradual rise in the pollutant in the atmosphere. That is, CO2 level almost crossing above 400 parts per million, and N2O concentration crossing above 300 parts per billion, and methane. So these are all the key indicators for the global warming or climate change. So some of the example I will show you the recent climate change or climate damage to the globe. That is, in 2016, Hurricane Cyclone, in 2017, North Atlantic Cyclone, North Coast of Kerala, in Indian Ocean, Idaya. These are all the tropical cyclone recently we observed, reported by World Meteorological Organization. And a heavy flood in 2017 August, Bangladesh, Nepal, and in 2018 Japan, and 2018 Kerala. So these are all the climate change due to the pollution in the atmosphere. And some of the heat waves observed in Pakistan and Europe, India. Due to heat waves, almost 2,000 people died in India and Pakistan, and Europe also about it due to heat waves. These are all the indicators for this global climate change. And forest fire also, we have been observing recently, 2015 Indonesia, 2019 Australia, 2018 Greece, and in USA, California. These are all forest fire. The recent times forest fire, we have been reading and observing in the globe. In addition to that, ice melt due to global warming towards 2 degrees C. These are all the climate change we have been seeing, we have been experiencing that. What is the reason for this climate change? Mainly from the energy sector. There are two kinds of energy. One is the electricity, and another one is the liquid fuel. Electricity we are using for the industry as well as for our domestic purposes. For liquid fuel, petrol and diesel, we are using for our mobility, car, other train, everything we are using liquid fuel, petrol or diesel. So the major pollution is from the electricity generation. Electricity generation from the coal is the main cause for this CO2 level rise in the atmosphere. And next one is the pollution due to vehicle emission, N2O emission and CO2 level emission from the vehicle. And we thought that we are going very fast in the highway. Actually, we are going very fast to cross the 2 degree C rise in temperature in the globe. If you see the vehicle emission alone, if you see, if you take scooter, three-wheeler, four-wheeler, five-wheelers, how much carbon dioxide we are emitting to the atmosphere per kilometer. If you take a scooter, almost 50 gram per kilometer. So how many kilometers, how many vehicle in India as well as in the world? So how much amount of CO2 emitted to the atmosphere, you can imagine. If you take big bus, for example, this one, if you use diesel or natural gas, almost we are emitting close to 1 kg per kilometer. So how many vehicles are in the India and as well as globe? So these are all the main reason for this global warming or climate change. Coming to India scenario, so recently I saw a report, most polluted city in the world, So among these, India, all cities are in Asia only. But if you count that number, 15 cities belongs to India, and that too, our capital, Delhi, nearby capital, Gurugram, Ghaziabad, Faridabad, all close to our capital. So 15 cities belong to India, that too, all close to our capital. So there is a very alarming situation for India, for the global pollution, Indian pollution level, as well as climate change. In addition to the pollution level, there is a rise in temperature in major cities. In highest level observed, 50 degree in Rajasthan and 45, average 45, this is called India fever. It is due to this global temperature rise. Almost 2,500 people died in 2018 itself. This is called global warming. So India itself is almost all cities experience is above 45. Maximum level is 50 in the Rajasthan. So we have to take severe, aggressive action to mitigate this effect, to live peacefully in this world. So what is the action? So currently we are using hydrocarbon-based energy system. So for electricity generation, we are using coal. That is also polluting. For our mobility, liquid fuel, petrol and diesel, that is also polluting our environment. And these are all not sustainable. It is polluting as well as it's not sustainable. For example, if there is no water in the ground, if due to rains, we can recharge it. But whereas we cannot recharge crude oil in the atmosphere. That is why we have to have a energy system that should not pollute our environment, and also it should sustain forever. So when you thought about these things, so instead of having hydrocarbon-based energy system or carbon-based energy system, why not have hydrogen itself as a fuel for sustainability as well as for non-polluting environment? If you take gases, hydrogen is available freely in the atmosphere or in the earth? No, it's not available. If you see in the atmosphere, the oxygen and nitrogen is available in the atmosphere. Hydrogen is not available freely, but it is available plenty in the earth in the form of water, in the form of hydrocarbon. If you again extract hydrogen from the hydrocarbon, again we are polluting the environment. If you take hydrogen from the water, it's not polluting and also it is sustainable. So we have plenty of water in the earth. From that we can extract hydrogen. From the hydrogen, we can sustain our energy system. So how we can extract hydrogen from the water? That is our primary focus of this topic. So water, we can get hydrogen and oxygen. We can let out oxygen to the atmosphere. We can consume hydrogen for our energy purpose. Is it new to this? No, it's not new to us, because water splitting reaction is, if you look at outside, you can see plenty of plant outside. So in plant, water splitting reaction taking place. Why water splitting reaction taking place? Plant, because plant is taking out carbon dioxide from the atmosphere and splitting water into hydrogen and oxygen. It is letting out oxygen to atmosphere and combining this hydrogen with the CO2, preparing sugar or carbohydrate for the plant and food for the human people and other living things. So this is the natural water splitting reaction, or we can call it as a photosynthesis, natural photosynthesis. Plant is splitting water, hydrogen and oxygen. It's not letting out hydrogen to the atmosphere. It's letting out oxygen for our breath. But it is consuming hydrogen to prepare the food. If it is letting out both, we can catch up. We can catch hydrogen and we can use it for the other energy purpose. It's not letting out only oxygen, not hydrogen. That is why we are going for artificial photosynthesis to split water and hydrogen, the laboratory to produce hydrogen for our energy purpose. What are the system available to split artificially water and hydrogen to oxygen? This is one method, that is semiconductor electrolyte method. So just semiconductor is material, it's a conductivity in between insulator and conductor, like copper is a conductor and other the wood is a semi-insulator. In between you have conductivity, there is semiconductor. If you have a proper semiconductor and you put it in the electrolyte, I mean water, you split water, hydrogen, oxygen, we can have plenty of, I mean, hydrogen, oxygen. But if currently the efficiency is very, very less, when you directly split, use solar energy to split water and hydrogen oxygen, very, very less efficiency. I will discuss what is the problem this the subsequent split. There is another way of splitting water is harnessing electricity from the atmosphere and using that electricity we can split water into hydrogen oxygen. So if you see, if you want to split water using heat energy, the temperature is about 2000. The temperature only water split into hydrogen oxygen. So we cannot have, there is no source available to split, have 2000 degree centigrade to split water into hydrogen oxygen. But this is a very, very simple to split water and hydrogen and oxygen. The required voltage, theoretical voltage, only 1.23 volt. That is the beauty of the electrochemistry. Instead of carrying out reaction at 2000 degree, we can carry out the reaction at 1.23 volt theoretically, but it may require some more additional voltage. That's such a simple system to carry out this water split reaction for our energy. So this is the combined thing of this natural water photosynthesis or water split reaction. These two are artificial way of splitting water and hydrogen and oxygen. So I am going to explain both the semiconductor water electrolysis and indirect way of using solar energy to split water and hydrogen and oxygen. The whole objective is, theme is energy and environment. Our mission is water for green fuel. In the specifically, instead of calling us hydrogen technology, we always as electrochemical oxygen technology, because oxygen evolution is the difficult reaction, as well as utilization of hydrogen through oxygen reduction is the difficult reaction. That is why we always call it as electrochemical oxygen technology instead of electrochemical hydrogen technology. So, and regarding oxygen evolution reaction, as I told you in the previous slide, there are two methods. One, electrochemical is the indirect way of generating hydrogen. We have to use two devices. This is direct way, photoelectrical, with this directly we can split only one device, just expose water to sunlight, we can split water. And this part is utilization, how we can utilize the generated hydrogen for our energy purpose. I will explain what are other things, I mean, problem associated with the electrochemical, photoelectrochemical, and utilization the subsequent slide. So regarding water electrolysis, theoretical potential is almost 1.23 volt. But if you want to split at a higher heating values, the theoretical potential is 1.48, that is thermoneutral voltage. If you split water at 1.48 volt, 100% efficiency, no loss of electricity. But that will not happen. Always some additional energy is required. That is called over potential. Anything above theoretical potential is called over potential. So here, the theoretical thermoneutral potential, thermoneutral voltage is 1.48. If you apply anything above the 1.48 volt, that is over voltage, that over voltage will be dissipated as heat, exothermic reaction. But if you operate and get vaccine efficiency 1.4, it is 100%. But if you want to operate the cell below thermonuclear voltage, the excess heat can be supplied from the surroundings. That is called endothermic reaction. We can reduce the electrical requirement for this water splitting reaction. And we can substitute the electrical requirement by endothermic reaction by supplying heat from the atmosphere. But below this region, we cannot split the water either by temperature or potential wave. So again, coming to the what are all the system available for this water splitting reaction, there is water electrolysis technology. So this water splitting technology can be classified based on the electrolyte or temperature. What is mean by electrolyte? Rainwater is not an electrolyte. It's only equivalent to distilled water. Whereas seawater is electrolyte because seawater contains majority of the sodium chloride and magnesium chloride, a small amount, and calcium chloride, other things. So when you dissolve some salt in water, that is called electrolyte. Here, in the electrochemistry also, we need electrolyte, main part, and electrolyte. All this reaction efficiency, everything is depending on the potential, water evolution potential, oxygen evolution potential, hydrogen evolution potential, all depending on the what kind of electrolyte you are using. This is again the electrolyte working condition is depending on the temperature. At what temperature this have maximum ionic conductivity. So this is playing a major role in economically generating hydrogen from the water electrolysis route. So this is solid oxide membrane electrolysis. This that occur at a very high temperature because the ionic conductivity of solid oxide membrane is at close to 1000 only to conduct ions. But alkaline is simple KOH solution, that is we can run up to 100 or 150. But the problem is we have to handle corrosive KOH solution. But most established system in the world is alkaline KOH solution. We also work on this. We have developed technology for this alkaline water electrolyte system. The another system is the proton exchange membrane. That is also very low temperature. Here, the materials are very costly, but it is user friendly compared to alkaline system. The proton exchange membrane is very user friendly. And the final system is the seawater. As I told you, seawater contains a lot of ions that will be used as the electrolyte for water splitting reaction. So we are working on this. Why it is changing, I don't know. We are working on this design of, as I told you, electrodes and the electrolytes playing a major role for hydrogen production, electrochemical as well as photoelectrochemical methods. First, let me discuss the electrochemical water splitting reaction. So this is the schematic of this water splitting reaction through membrane electrolysis. This central portion, white portion, is called the ionically conducting part. This plus anode is called electronically conducting electrodes. It may be metal or metal oxide, as well as in the cathode side also, be metal or metal oxide. So first, we have to, in electrochemistry, electrodes and electrolytes are very important. We have to establish electrode-electrolyte interface. Then only we can carry out any electrochemical reaction, whether it is galvanic cell or electrochemical cell, electrode-electrolyte interface is playing a major role in any kind of electrochemical reaction. If you have solid-liquid electrochemical interface, you don't bother about the establishing interface, electrode-electrode interface, because when you put ion electrode or nickel electrode into KOH solution, immediately the interface, contact will be established quickly. We don't need to struggle that. When you put any electrode or metal oxide into the KOH solution or sulfuric acid solution, immediately that interface will be established. Whereas in the case of both are solid, for example, electrolyte also solid, electrode also solid, both are solid, then interfacing is a major problem. But if once you establish, is easy to operate the system. For example, alkaline electrolysis, prepare some 30% KO solution, put to nickel electrode, quickly we can do some pass some 2 volt like that, immediately you get hydrogen oxide. So they are establishing electrochemical interface is not a difficult process when you have solid electrode and liquid electrolyte. Whereas in this membrane process, the center portion is the membrane process. It looks like exactly physically, if you see the polythene, exactly transparent polythene paper. But polythene paper will not contact any ions. Whereas this special kind of polymers will contact ions. For particular ion only. Some polymers will contact cations, some polymers will contact anion. In our case, it contact only cation, that is specifically proton. So the total system, how it operate, how we can reduce the energy requirement by reducing the operating voltage. So the V0 is the theoretical potential, so that we cannot alter. There is thermodynamic potential, we cannot alter that. And the on or over potential, this is the cathode over potential, this is the interfacial resistance, the resistance between the solid electrolyte and a solid electrode, it may be metal or metal oxide. This is the major portion we have to concentrate to establish the interface. And this is the conductivity of this, ionic conductivity of this membrane. So all the four contribute for the total voltage. So this cannot be altered. Other things, anode over potential, cathode over potential, interfacial resistance between the ionically and the electronically conducting part, and this ionic conductivity of this particular membrane. So our whole objective is to reduce the over potential, anode over potential, cathode over potential, interfacial resistance, and ionic conductivity. If you reduce all the things, we can be able to have a economically viable electrolyzer for generating electricity. So in Sikri, so there are several methods available to interface solid electrolyte and solid electrode in Sikri. So we have adopted some methods in order to have higher efficient electrodes. We have prepared this catalyst. Usually the catalyst is prepared separately. This electrode is prepared, the powder or metal oxide prepared exclusively. And by pressing method, we are interfacing this, electrolyte and electrode. That is a conventional way of producing that. Sometimes the contact will not be good. That will reduce the performance of this water electrolyzer. In Sikri, we developed some method to prepare the catalyst in-situly on the electrode by having ion exchange and put reducing agent. In addition to that reducing agent, we also added surfactant in order to reduce the particle size. So this is the measure. So when you polarize from the equilibrium potential, so this is zero. Here there is no reaction. But if you above around 800 millivolt, gas solution taking place. That is the steep rise in current. And if you have smaller particle, the over potential is very, very less. For bigger particle, the over potential, electrical requirement is more. This is why we primarily concentrate on this, how to screen the catalyst. If it is more over potential, we cannot use that. It is less over potential. In our case also, same material is platinum. But if we have smaller particle, the over potential is almost 200 millivolt, that is 0.2 volt. You may say, what is the grade of 0.2 volt, 200 millivolt? But for one cell, if you have more cell, each cell 200 millivolt add, if you have almost 5 cell, almost 1 volt will block. Okay. That is why we are initially screening this material by polarizing the electrode, different electrolyte, and optimized condition, optimized high efficient electrode only, we are incorporating in the commercial viable technology. So, and preparing the catalyst, we have assembled a small cell initially that generates 800 liter per hour capacity hydrogen, and we operate a cell at different temperature. When you look at, if you raise the temperature endothermically, if you supply temperature from the outside, so voltage is reduced. So we can reduce the electrical requirement by if we supply heat from the surroundings. Thereby, we can reduce the electricity consumption for hydrogen generation. This is the small unit assembled for hydrogenation of reaction to carry out reaction in the laboratory. And this is the big unit. This is 1000 liter per hour capacity. And we also developed technology that is being used several places in India as well as in abroad. Currently, we have connected this electrolyzer, as I told you, to device. This is solar panel. From the solar panel, we'll collect electricity from the photons, and we are operating the electrolyzer inside the room. The electricity is from the solar. This is green way of generating hydrogen from solar water. And our installation at many places, one at BRC Mumbai is operating, and another at civil aviation department of Oman. There, civil aviation morning and evening they have to launch weather balloon. So hydrogen is the lightest gas. That is why they install all the sensor in the bottom of the balloon and the launch from the launch station, and it will go up certain distance. From there, it collect weather condition and they send the data to the ground station whether we can take flight or not. Those things can work. This is also another small application for this hydrogen. So we have supplied our hydrogen generator to the Oman. They have been using this for weather monitoring of Air Force Station. So coming to the next system, this is direct way of splitting water into hydrogen and oxygen. This is here we have to use two systems. One is water volatility system, and another is water volatility that is inside.